Hey guys, happy Monday. I hope that you're doing well. Dory says hi too. I miss you guys, and I hope that you're doing well, staying safe and staying healthy. We're going to go ahead and get started on today's lesson. Have a great week.
Okay, if you turn your books to page 277, we're gonna go ahead and get started. Today's learning target, or we have two actually. One says, I will explain the author's purpose and message within a text. And then the second one says, I will analyze how the use of text structure contributes to the author's purpose. Now, remember, text structure is chronological order, cause and effect, problem and solution. We talked about it a couple weeks ago. So, and then author's purpose, of course, is why the author is writing this story. As always, we're going to start with you taking a few minutes to read your reader's tips, which is on page 278. Now, this time, instead of waiting for me to highlight point out important phrases or words or sentences, I want you to do that. So as you're reading, I want you to be highlighting, if you don't have a highlighter, underline things that specifically stand out to you. So a couple of things that stood out to me as I was reading is, and should have stood out to you hopefully, is if you look at paragraph one there, they tell us that the author's purpose is the reason or reasons the author has for writing the text. So they wrote the text for a reason, and it goes beyond just to persuade us or inform us or entertain us. So there's a purpose, a reason. Make sure you have that underlined if you don't have it underlined already. And then also in paragraph two, they talk about text structure and how it contributes to the author's purpose or the author's message. So when an author chooses a specific structure and how they organize the text, they might choose chronological order, right? But when they choose this structure, it's for a reason. It helps them achieve their purpose, okay? And then if you look there at the bottom, it says, when you read literary text, think about these questions. So these are the questions that we need to be thinking about. One, why does the author write the story, right? So why? There's a reason. If they're informing us, great. What are they informing us about? Okay. Two, what message does the author want me to learn after reading this? So message is typically what? Theme, right? Three, how does the author structure the text? So this right here is text structure, how they organize it. Four, how does the structure of the text help understand the author's purpose? So when we know that this contributes to the author's purpose in some way, and we need to figure out how. And then five, how does the structure of the text help us understand the author's message? So, as we're reading, I want you to be thinking about those questions.
Okay, so today's story is on page 279, and it is titled Best Friends. So I want you to, of course, write down RNAG, RQPC, and then NAG at the bottom. Now I want you to pay attention. At the bottom there, I added something. I added three words: purpose, theme, and structure. So as you're reading today, before we even get to the questions, I really want you to think about these three things, okay? First time when you read it, just read it all the way through and then complete NAG. Now when you do the second R, like you're supposed to, these are the three things I want you thinking about and I want you writing down. So one is, what is the author's purpose, okay? Two is, what is the theme? What is the lesson, the message that the author wanted me to know? And then three, the structure. Did the author organize it in chronological order? Did the author organize it by comparing and contrasting, by problem and solution, by cause and effect, by description, describing something? Okay, so think about how they're organizing the story. And I want you, underneath these three words here, I want you to write down what your thoughts are. So again, we're going to take it an extra step. Instead of just R, nag, R right now, you are also going to write down your thoughts on what the author's purpose is, why they're writing the story, what you think the lesson is, and how they're organizing the story. Go ahead and pause the video and take a few minutes to do that. Okay, at this point, you should have R, nag, R checked off. You should have nag written down at the bottom. And then you should also have purpose, theme, and structure checked off if you wrote something underneath there. We're gonna go ahead and get started on today's questions. Now, if you did not do purpose, theme, and structure, please pause the video and do that because I promise it's gonna help you on your questions today. All right, let's take a look at number one. Number one says, the author wrote this text most likely to. Okay, so they, wrote this story for a reason. What was that reason? So if you wrote some notes down on your story when I asked you what the purpose was, this should help you. Okay, so I want you to take a moment to read through your answer choices on your own. Make sure that you, because it is more than one word in your answer choices, make sure that you are highlighting those keywords. So for example, in A, describe would be a keyword. In B, provide facts. C would be share, unexpected. D would be emphasize, right? Remember, emphasize means to show importance. Now, there may be some other keywords, but those are just some keywords. So make sure that you're paying attention to those as you are reading these answer choices, because we know that just one word can make an answer wrong. So go through the process, make sure you eliminate your sillies, your distractor, and get your correct answer. All right, let's take a look at number two. Number two says, what is the message of the text? So when we think message, what should we think of? It should be theme, right? Remember, the message. Okay, so I asked you at the beginning, before you started reading, to think about the theme. This is why, because I knew you were going to have a question on it. So you have F, friends know each other's strengths. G, a true friend will always apologize. H, friendship changes over time. Or J, friends will offer help. Now remember, this is lesson, life lesson. So think about what maybe the main character learned and how we can apply that in real life, and that will be your answer, okay? Eliminate your way offs, and then distinguish the difference between your distractor and your correct answer. Okay, and the last one, number three, the structure of the text contributes to the author's purpose because the chronological order of events helps the reader understand. Okay, so structure contributes to the author's purpose, and they're telling us that the structure is chronological order. What does it help us understand? So at this point, we should already have identified the author's purpose, right? Which was number one. Number one was your author's purpose. They're giving us the text structure, which is chronological order. Okay, so they're telling me the author chose to write this story in chronological order because it's somehow helping achieve their purpose for writing the story. So how does reading this story in chronological order help the reader understand? Or what does it help the reader understand? All right, so at this point, you should be able to check off Q and P. The last thing you need to do is obviously the check part. Please make sure that you have your proof for every question. Obviously, these questions, most of them, the proof would be whole story, okay? And of course, you're going to be submitting your answers the same way. You're gonna click on the link below and submit your answers on quizzes. I appreciate those of you who have been keeping up with your work. Remember, Mr. V is going to have a little surprise, another little raffle for those of you who are keeping up with all subjects. Okay. If you are missing something and you're not sure what lesson, reach out to me and I will let you know what you are missing. And I hope that you have a wonderful Monday. And oh, just a reminder, if you do need help on a specific question, don't forget, you can always give me a call so that I can assist you. Have a great one, guys.
Good morning, guys. I hope that you had an amazing three-day weekend. Today, we're going to finish up our unit on adaptations by doing a quick review, and then you're going to finish up on quizzes. If you need any help, please reach out. Let's go ahead and get started. Okay, once again, guys, you've amazed me. You've done an amazing job ending this unit of adaptations. So today we're just going to review, and then you will answer some final questions over adaptations on quizzes. So let's go ahead and get started. The definition of adaptations are structures that have functions to help organisms survive in their specific environments. Now remember, the structures are the physical features and functions are the way those physical features are used to help the organisms. So let's go through a couple examples. So strong legs might help an animal run fast, like the cheetah. Fins and webbed feet might help an organism swim in water, like the duck or the dolphins. And not only are adaptations for animals, but also all living organisms, including plants. So our last example on this slide are spines on a cactus that help the plant conserve water in the desert. Now some organisms have sharp claws or sticky feet that allow them to be good climbers, like these two pictures here. Some have wings and hollow bones so that they can fly, like the eagle. And some have strong muscular legs that are good for animals who move by jumping, like the kangaroo. But ultimately, by ending this unit, you need to understand that each organism is adapted to survive in its own unique environment. Like I said, you guys have done an amazing job. I'm so impressed with you all during this virtual learning. I miss you guys, and I wish you the best of luck. All right, guys, find Ms. Broberg's quizzes link to take your assessment, and you will be done with this unit.
Okay, Mystery Bodas class, please find his link. Every question is both in English and in Spanish, so find Mystery Bodas quizzes link to finish your assessment for the day.
Hey guys, happy Monday. So I just wanted to share real quick that if you have missed only one question or gotten 100 on the last two quizzes, if you do that again on Friday, you're gonna have the chance to win a whole large pizza that's going to be delivered to your house on Friday. So keep up with the work. Good job to all of you. Make sure that you really understand what we're doing, because there's going to be continue to be cool prizes like these until school ends. And we only have, I feel like, 4 more weeks of school, so it's gonna be really cool. All right, so let's go and get started with some math. Alright, so your up to today says a piece of wire was 12 3600 centimeters long. Thayil cut the wire into 6 pieces of equal length. What was the length of each piece of wire in centimeters? So go ahead and either break or make a total there. Your order of operations is extremely simple today. Your fraction says Kara walked 4/5 of a mile on Tuesday and 3/10 of a mile on Thursday. Find the number of miles Kara walked on both days. Go ahead and pause it right here. Do your UPSI order of operation, your fraction. Go ahead and send it to me. It's like 1, 2, 3, just as easy as can be. Okay, so now what we're going to do is that I'm going to show you 3 different problems. I'm going to do 2 for you. And you have to copy all of the notes down, and you're going to do the 3rd one on your own, and that's your assignment for today. It's going to get started. All right, so this is the first problem. A construction company completes 3/5 of the remodels by Tuesday. What percentage did the construction company complete? Look, they're asking you for the percentage, and they gave you a fraction. So we're going to have to convert that fraction into a percent, which is what we talked about last week. All right, here are your notes for number one. They want to know they completed 3/5 of the remodels, and we want to know what does that look like in percentage. Remember that percent means out of 100. So what does this look like if it's out of 100? How many fits? 3 of them. So we need 1/5 out of 100, 2/5 out of 100, 3/5 out of 100. So how many hundreds am I gonna break up into 5? 1, 2, 300. 300 divided by 5 is going to give me my percentage. So I'm gonna make 300s, divide them into 5ths. 0 on top, 0 on the bottom. That is 30 now. 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30. It's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6 times 5 is 30. Bring down your 0. 60. 0 minus 0. 60%. 60 out of 100. Or 60%. That would be your answer right here. 60% of the. Okay, so that model at the very, very top shows what 60% looks like. The green part, guys, that is 60% of the whole thing. So it would be 3/5 equals 60 over 100, which equals 60%. All right, here's problem number 2. This is the second one that I'm going to do with you. It says Leslie answered 3/4 of the test correctly. What is the percentage of her score? So if we have 3/4, that means you have a fourth, and a fourth. What is that percentage going to be? So you would take 3/100, because you have 3/4, and divide it into 4, because it's 3/4. That's what the fraction looks like. So this is what we are doing. We're taking 3/4. We want to know what that would look like, because we got 3/4 of the test correct. What would that look like out of 100? So I'm going to take 3/100, because it's 3/4, and I'm going to divide it by 4 because that's what my denominator is. 0 on top, 0 on the bottom. Again, 30. 4, 8, 12, 16, 20, 24, 28. There it is. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. 28 right here. You would regroup. It's going to be 2. Get 20. 20 is right here. It's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 75. 75 out of 100. That is what 3/4 is. So 3/4 equals 75%. So going back to the problem that we were looking at, Leslie would have gotten a 75% on her test. Now that model at the very, very top, 3/4 is 75% of the whole thing. So 3/4 equals 75 over 100, which equals 75%. All right, this is the one that you're going to do on your own. Jason saves 2/5 of what he needs to buy a new phone case. What percentage has he saved? So you have to convert 2 out of 5 or 2/5 into a percentage. Now remember that a percentage means out of 100. So all you have to do is you have to find the equivalent fraction of 2/5 if it was out of 100. But it's 2/5, guys, so make sure you're dividing 200 into 5. And that's going to give you your answer for today. As always, I miss you guys. Keep sending me your work. I cannot wait to see who's going to win the pizza on Friday. Keep up the good work, and I'll be texting you guys, telling you if you're getting these answers correctly or not, so that you can fix them. I'll see you guys on Wednesday.
Happy Monday, guys. Buenos dias para este lunes. You can have an easy Monday. I believe it's going to be an easy Monday. You're going to have your UPSIs to begin with. You have an addition and subtraction and then an order of operations, but I'm not going to tell you which one's addition and which one is subtraction. You have to figure that out. Okay? Then I'm going to show you a word problem similar to what we did last week. Last week, you just went from fractions, converted fractions to percentages. Well, you're going to be doing the same thing, but now it's in a word problem. So I gave you a sample one. Copy it down. Look how I worked it out. Make sure you write it down. And then there's only 2 problems for you to do. So I know you can do that. So make sure you get them done. Get a picture of it and send it to me. That way you can get an easy 100. Have a great Monday.
Okay, guys. Here's your UPSI and order of operations for Monday, April 27th. There's your first one. I'm not going to read it to you. Remember, we're reviewing adding and subtracting fractions. There's your order of operations. And here's your second UPSI here. Okay, you'll have to figure out which ones you're adding and which ones you are subtracting. So make sure you write it down on a paper and then show me your work. Okay, remember what we were doing last week and when we were just converting fractions to percentages? Well, you're going to be doing the same thing, but now you have it in word form. So now you have a word problem. So I want you to show me, give me the fraction, show me your work, and then show me your percentage. So on this one right here, we're talking about 6/8 of the students got a 90 or higher in the reading test. So in order to get a percentage, we have to divide 8 into 6. And remember, you have to add the 2 zeros here. So 8 into 60 goes 7 times. 7 times 8 is 56. Subtract. Got to regroup here. So that's 6 away from 10. That's 4. Bring down your 0 is 40. 8 into 40 is 5. 5 times 8 is 40. Subtract is 0. So make sure that when you're writing down your problems, you write down the minus sign. Because some of you are not doing that, okay? Okay, here are your 2 problems for Monday. These are the ones that the type of problems we did last week on converting fractions into percentages. So make sure you write the problem down and then work it out. It's in English and Spanish, so there's no excuse for you not doing it. It's the same word problem, just two different languages. Okay? And I'm not going to read it to you.